Honorable Speaker Sir, Honorable Prime Minister, Honorable Leader of Opposition, Honorable Members of Parliament, thank you, Honorable Speaker Sir. I wish to speak on the topic call for action to protect our rivers. But before that, Speaker Sir, I just want to bring to your attention, you would have noted how Honorable Minister for Industry and Trade and Local Government tried to explain very eloquently how we need to develop responses and solutions based on development needs of our country. She very aptly, based on research, demonstrated that, you know, within the Pacific region, the small states, Caribbean region, what is the current practice? Continuously wish to see response from the other side saying we need elections. We need elections. We need elections. Honorable Speaker Sir, I term that as tramline thinking. One track mind, not willing to think outside the box, looking for proposing solutions out of textbooks learned in the universities and high school. Honorable Speaker, say, this is the place where we need to think outside the box, work outside the tram line, go to a soccer field, sit, stand in the middle, and look all around and say, look right around and say, there's so much opportunity out there. Honorable Speaker, Sir, 14th of March was the International Day of Action for Rivers, dedicated to honor our life-giving rivers and appreciate actions of those who have ensured that our rivers continue flowing. Speaker say, it is a day dedicated to solidarity, when we all come together in unison to say that our rivers matter. Speaker say, our rivers are our lifeline, and having access to clean and flowing water matters. Speaker say, the International Day of Action for Rivers empowers us to have a say in decisions that affect our rivers and our lives. This year marks the 22nd year for the International Day of Action for Rivers. The International Day of Action Against Dams and for Rivers, Water and Life was adopted during the first international meeting of people affected by dams, March 1997 in Curitiba, Brazil. The aim of that meeting was to ensure healthy and vibrant watersheds and equitable and sustainable management of our rivers, including addressing river regulations by dams. Speaker say, the International Day of Action for Rivers is a day marked for people to rise up to celebrate and protect their rivers. The fight for rivers is a fight for future. And given our connection to waterways in Fiji, it is vital that we take this seriously. Speaker say, while having a discourse on rivers and its importance, we also celebrated the life-giving rivers and advocate river health and restoration. Honorable Speaker say, that day is a day to reflect on our current efforts to sustain our rivers and demand improvements in policies and practices so that our rivers are clean and immaculate. It is on this day that water enthusiasts and environmentalists raise their voices in harmony to denounce unsustainable water development projects, rescue our rivers and watersheds, and demand equitable and sustainable management of waterways. Together, they demonstrate that issues surrounding waterways and rivers are not local, but global in scope, and such, apart from local activities, global actions also are needed. Mr. Speaker, sir, just a few weeks back, on the 8th of March, we celebrated International Women's Day. Women are intrinsically linked to environment and waterways. The theme of this year's International Day of Action for Rivers is, I quote, celebration of the role of women in protecting and managing our rivers, unquote. Speakers say, women are at the forefront when it comes to water management or natural resources management. Oftentimes, women are the main users of water in households and communities. Mr. Speaker say, it is these women who are tasked with securing, sustaining, and using water resources. Furthermore, it is these women who fetch food from rivers. Some women in our rural areas spend more time fetching food from the river than any other activity. Women are inherently related to the sustainability of our rivers, yet are often singled out during decision making. It is this paradox of their participation in decision making with regards to water and river management this year's theme aspires to achieve. It is time now to address these inequalities and promote water leaders in our communities. Mr. Speaker, say, to mark this globally, the inaugural Women and Rivers Conference was convened in Kathmandu, Nepal from March 6 to 10, 2019. The Congress aimed to empower women to raise their voices on behalf of our freshwater resources. To achieve this locally, we need greater women participation in resource management, transparency in the development and implementation of water policies, along with empowerment of women and local communities. Only through this, we shall be able to achieve inalienable rights of communities to manage their water, forests, and other resources, and sustain the right of every person to a healthy environment. Mr. Speaker, say, for us in Fiji, rivers sustain our life. We depend on them for food, transport, and recreation. Rivers are an integral to our traditions and customs. We have taken so much from our rivers. But what is it that we are given back to these rivers? Besides dumping our rubbish, contributing to siltation, poisoning its waters with waste and chemicals from farms and factories, we are literally killing the riverine ecosystem bit by bit. We are clogging these life-giving arteries of our nature and have destined ourselves for certain disaster if we don't change our conduct and behavior. Our one-sided development paradigm has singled the death knell of rivers. We all, through our actions, will soon be responsible if we don't react now. Mr. Speaker, say, rivers also play a very important role in agricultural development. Rivers are associated with alluvial soils and provide the most productive agricultural land of the country. It also provides water for sustainable agriculture, both crops and livestock, as well as for food processing. It further provides a means of transportation for interior parts of the country's population. Rivers support the livelihood of people by providing water for various kinds of domestic uses. It serves as a source of protein and support ecotourism activities. Most of our economic centers are located on the riverbank of major river, on the banks of major rivers. Hence, it becomes vital that we take care of our rivers now before it becomes too late. Mr. Speaker, say, our rivers are under threat from our activities. While rivers have always given us life, we are suffocating our rivers by treating it as a rubbish dump. We are facing unprecedented impacts of climate change that is threatening our livelihood and our very existence. Mr. Speaker, say, we as a nation, led by Honorable Prime Minister, have led the charge to address climate change's impact on small island states at the global level. We have embarked on a new vision for our collective future. Our future to have resilient communities. It is true that water is at the heart of many of today's struggles. Decisions about how our waterways are used, managed, and developed affects the lives of many. For us in Fiji, our rivers are sacred. It gives us water and life without which we could not exist. Our livelihoods and cultures are deeply connected to our rivers. The situation is as dire for us as any other riverine community in the world. Mr. Speaker, say, as such, we need to rethink development concerning our water resources and waterways. We should not be gullible to the greed of capitalism, greed for short-term gains by polluting our rivers and create water crisis. Neither shall we let our actions choke our rivers. Let's mark this year and years ahead to raise awareness about the importance of clean water waterways and voice concerns for improved water governance and environmental flows in rivers. Mr. Speaker, say, our government is committed to safeguarding our waterway environment, to maintain the inextricable bondage between a river and various forms of life. We have various laws, including the Environmental Management Act 2005 and associated regulations, the Litter Act 2008, the Drainage Amended Act 2018, that are aimed at safeguarding these resources in our environment. The Ministry of Waterways and Environment has started to vigorously enforce this legislation. To mark this, we have, over the last 4 weeks, trained approximately 500 litter prevention officers in Suva and Tabuni from various government agencies and departments to monitor litter issues. This litter often ends up in our waterways, causing pollution and other environmental problems. We will also use the above and other legislations to prosecute anyone who uses chemicals to obtain short-term gains from our waterways. Furthermore, Mr. Speaker, riverbank erosion has been a major issue surrounding our rivers. Riverbank erosion is a natural and inevitable phenomenon and can be defined as a dynamic and natural process which involves the removal of materials from the banks of a river. Rivers and streams are dynamic systems as they are constantly changing. The natural equilibrium, however, is exacerbated through our activities. Riverbank erosion is often accelerated through flooding, unsustainable land use, stream management, overclearing of catchment, and riparian vegetation, poorly managed gravel extraction, which destabilizes the banks. Mr. Speaker, in Fiji, a considerable percentage of the population live along the banks of meandering rivers and in other high-risk zones. While they have lived in harmony with the river in the past, things have started to change now. These communities are now more vulnerable than ever before. Their personal safety and shelter, as well as sources of their livelihood, are a threat from riverbank erosion and its impacts. Mr. Speaker, unattended riverbank erosion may have a major consequence on human settlements and agriculture activity. Our villages, roads, public infrastructure, and agriculture land are being threatened by riverbank erosion. Parts of the Singhitoka Valley River are being washed away at a rate of 8 meters every year. And with this, we are losing the valley alluvial arable land, which has been the main base for the valley roads vegetable production. Roads are being washed away, schools are threatened. Speakers say displacement and relocations are likely to occur in the riverside regions where people are vulnerable to riverbank erosion, and this has multiple socioeconomic impacts. These include loss of home, agricultural land, asset, human health, and loss of accumulated human capital. Mr. Speaker, our Ministry of Waterways and Environment has now embarked on a nature-based solution to respond to a problem caused by nature. We have begun planting vetiver grass alongside the river banks to stabilize the bank and prevent it from any further erosion. Approximately 500 meters of riverbank along the Nawedovaku village in Wanimbuku has been stabilized using vetiver technology, and this will be further scaled up to other river systems in the country. Mr. Speaker, the goal of this project is to reduce riverbank erosion through an ecological approach using vetiver technology, planned, delivered, and maintained through communities, making this project a unique one. It is unique in the sense that it empowers the community to defend themselves from riverbank erosion, and doing so, evolving the techniques and building necessary capacity to protect their own communities. Mr. Speaker, this project further reflects the responsibility and work taken up by the Nawedovaku community towards ensuring our environment is in a better state for the future. I applaud the Nawedovaku community for having such foresight and taking up this responsibility to secure their existence from the encroaching river. Furthermore, in doing so, this community are doing their part to help sequestrate carbon and help our nation achieve our commitments under the climate agreements. Mr. Speaker, the vetiver system is a very simple, practical, inexpensive, and effective biological measure to soil and water conservation. Vetiver grass was introduced in Fiji over 100 years ago, and it has been widely used for soil and water conservation purposes for more than 50 years. Vetiver has been a very important component of soil erosion control on the sugarcane lands around Lotoka and Rekereke from 1960s until fairly recently. The Land and Water Land Resource Planning Division of Ministry of Agriculture has been involved in vetiver systems to arrest soil erosion issues in farms. The vetiver grass has a distinctive morphological, physiological, and ecological characteristics. Together with its tolerance to highly adverse growing conditions, provide a unique bioengineering tool for land stabilization, flood, and stream bank erosion control. It is a non-invasive, a very good pollution control that's making ideal for soil and water conservation. Mr. Speaker, Nawedovaku community as a village has planted 400 meters of vetiver along the riverbank aimed at protecting the village from erosion. Furthermore, fruit trees are also planted to support nutritional security in the village, with the surplus going to the roadside stalls or markets on the weekend. This project has been a village initiative with both men and women involved in planting the vetiver. Mr. Speaker said there are multiple benefits associated with promoting vetiver for riverbank and slope stabilization. Some of these are A, conserve soil and water, runoff retention in the farmlands, B, it is a low-cost bioengineering tool, it is a green technology, as such help sequestrate carbon. D, the tensile strength of vetiver roots is as strong and long and has massive root network which is very fast growing. It is better than many types of trees which normally take 2 to 3 years to be effective. The speaker say the riverbank protection will further provide the following banks to the Naivivatu village: protection of land and protection of erosion, stabilization of the riverbank reduces loss of agricultural land, reduction of excessive sedimentation within watercourse which splits up gravel beds and destroys spawning and invertebrate habitat, and lastly, reduction of channel widening and associated flow issues. Mr. Speaker said, I would like to take this opportunity to urge donors, NGOs and other agencies to promote vetiver as a tool for riverbank stabilization and for erosion control purposes. We need to work together to scale up such nature-based solutions and approaches and use it as a vegetative candidate for bioengineering river stabilization work. Mr. Speaker said, I now wish to invite them to provide funding to take ownership of matching commitment with us. We intend to do 100 kilometers every year. We invite NGOs to commit funding for 25 kilometers and the private sector to also come forward and commit funding for 25 kilometers, while we will take the other 50 kilometers, therefore 100 kilometers every day, every year for the next 4 years. We also urge them to adopt this unique community-based model whereby we pay the community $12.20 per meter, which is equivalent to $12,200 per kilometer. The speaker say this amount goes to the community, while the community themselves, who are trained by us and supervised by us, gets the required variety of vetiver and does the planting themselves. In this way, we can achieve a community-based 100 kilometers per year vetiver grass plantation along the riverbanks throughout Fiji. The community takes full ownership of the project, Mr. Speaker said, and this is an amazing way of delivering this particular project. Apart from this being a nature-based solution, this is also a community-centric approach, and the ministry empowers the local community to address riverbank erosion through ecological means. The ministry will further integrate ecosystem-based approaches into its hard infrastructure engineering solutions to address riverbank and coastal erosion problems. Mr. Speaker said, to conclude, it is vital to ensure that our rivers must flow freely, fearlessly, and without its water quality being compromised. Again, I repeat, Mr. Speaker said, it is vital to ensure that our rivers must flow freely, fearlessly, and without its water quality being compromised. Furthermore, as it is now a source of livelihood, means of transportation, avenue for leisure activities, and support for agriculture and non-agriculture sector, our activities in and around it should not lead to it becoming a constraint to livelihood and growth or a threat to our infrastructure. Just as we all have a right to live, every river also has a right to live its life. Located anywhere in the world, we have a common struggle when it comes to water waste management. Mr. Speaker said, it is therefore necessary to implement ways to manage our fresh waters, which are equitable, sustainable, and effective. As such, I urge fellow Fijians to get together against the deleterious river pollution by litter chemicals, unsustainable gravel extraction, or indiscriminate deforestation. Let's do our part for conservation and truly sustainable development of our rivers. I ask all Fijians to pledge to protect our rivers and waterways from pollution, ensure environmental flows are sustained, clean our rivers, waterways, and take up activities to restore our rivers to its pristine and natural status. Let's show our commitment to not only the current generation, but the future generation as well. Thank you. Now.